In this tutorial, I'm going to use the scenic gem for Ruby on Rails to take two tables in our database and then combine them together into a single table called a database view. And then we're going to wrap that in a regular model. So when you try and access it, it feels like a normal Rails model. And I'm also going to show you how you can test it as well. So let's jump in. So I'm a massive fan of using database views to kind of combine tables together for when you've got to search them or as a way of storing complicated SQL queries. You're probably wondering what I kind of mean by this. I'm going to give you a very quick example. So in this post table, I've got like this body here, and in my comments, I have the body. And what I really want to do in this application is I want to just combine those fields, or these tables together, and maybe do a search on that body field. So I've written kind of some very lazy looking SQL here. And what this is going to do is it's going to select the comments body field and just call it body. And we're going to union connect that to another SQL statement, which is like, hey, get all the post body, call it body as well, and do that. So let's see what this returns. So you can see we've got a bunch of data there. We've got what, one, two, well, six rows, and we have three posts and three comments. So that makes a lot of sense. And what we're going to do is we're going to make this so this appears in here and pretend to be like its own table using the scenic gem. The scenic gem is so good. What it will do is in Ruby on Rails, it will allow you to create database views and store them like in like version control and make them look like migrations. It's really fantastic. I'm going to jump right in and just start using it on my current application here. So I'm going to start by doing bundle add scenic, and this is going to add it to our gem file. Cool. And we can see that's been added there. If we do git status. Yep, that's that. So adding scenic gem. And the next thing we're going to do is we're going to generate a view and or a migration to create a view. And they kind of have got us started here by doing Rails generate. So this is very cool. So we could do bundle exec Rails generate scenic view, and I'm gonna call mine views underscore all underscore users content. So yeah, that should be pretty good. Let's see how that looks. Nice. So if we were to quickly open this file in Vim, can see we have a pretty very approachable looking migration looking thing there. And it's also added a little views folder here where all of our database views are going to live. And you can see it's got v1. So if we were to create new ones or secondary ones, it's going to be like v2, v3, v4, etc. And I'm just going to really quickly dump this query into that file. And RailsDB, oops, sorry, bundle exec RailsDB migrate, just to migrate our database very quickly. Okay, that worked fantastically. And what I really like about this gem, and this is what makes this gem so special to me, and whenever I'm doing views, this is the reason I like love this, is it will just add it into the schema RB like this. So it's kind of quite obvious to know like that there's a view in the database and it's happening. And when I actually go into the database here, there's my view. That's awesome. So this is pretty awesome right now. If someone was to connect to our database, we could be like, hey, here's that information you want. Just go to the views, like whatever table, and they'll get everything they want. But let's turn this up to 11. Wouldn't it be cool if we could access this through like a regular Rails model? So what we're going to do is exactly that. We're going to do bundle exec Rails G model. And so we're going to tell Rails to generate a model, and we're going to call it views, and we're going to kind of nest it a little bit, And we're going to call it all users content, and we're going to pass the flag no migration. So this name kind of matches up with what we have here. We've got all users content, there. So actually that's contents. This is content. Yep, that should be all good. We're going to run this. And we got it. It didn't make a migration because we didn't ask it to, but we get a nice like factory and a few other things. So we could probably delete this factory out. It doesn't really need to be there. So because it's a database view, it doesn't really exist. But let's have a little look at this model in Vim. Let's have a look and see what it looks like. So it's pretty empty right now. Okay, so I'm going to quickly go to the Rails console now. And I'm gonna, so normally you'd run bundle.xrc. I've got it like kind of abbreviated as an alias. And I'm just gonna quickly go all. There they are, there's everything. That's pulling it in. And if I wanted to do like where, I don't know, body, sample body, there you go. I can now query that like whole set of data very, very easily. So that's very cool. So this is pretty good, but it'd be really good if we could access the original model it came from in case we needed to do something with that. I'm going to quickly commit what we've done so far. So I'm going to say adding model for our DBV. And we're going to change our SQL query just a little bit. And I'm going to start by just writing this in here like before. And gonna make a little bit of space. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna make the database think it has a polymorphic relationship to the original object. So I'm gonna good quotes. I'm gonna add a field called comment, and it's gonna be called a contentable type. And we're gonna also give this an ID. ID, and we're gonna be like comments.id. And we're gonna duplicate this for our posts kind of select as well. So let's kind of get that in there. And we're gonna say post and post ID. So let's see what this does on current. I have a syntax error. Where is the syntax error? Oh, here we go. I have the comment in there. The comment in there. That's all good. Okay, cool. So now we have this contentable column. And we're going to update our view to use this new SQL. I'm just going to click the beautify button because that makes it beautiful. So I'm going to quickly do bundle exec Rails DB rollback. This is just going to take our database, remove that view. Then we can edit the previous file because I haven't actually committed too much up. So, or I haven't run it in production yet. So we're all good. There's no need to worry there even. So we're going to go to views file here. And I'm just going to smash in that SQL. And let's very quickly go migrate. Cool. There we go. Our view has that contentable magic there. And we're now going to quickly update our model to have a belongs to contentable. And then we're going to say polymorphic. True. Okay, so if you've never used polymorphics before, the idea is you can connect them to any kind of like model, and it's just kind of a very powerful way of doing like a belongs to. So let's have a look what that actually does. So I'm gonna quickly reload my console here, and we're gonna just get all of these. You can see we have this contentable. Oops, let's get the last one, or the first one even. We'll come back to sorting this one out in just a second. So we're gonna get the first row, and let's just do contentable. Sweet. So that's very cool. So it's found that, you know, our first object, it's hey, I found a penny. It's a comment, and the comment ID is number 3. And if we call contentable, which is the name of our relationship there that belongs to, it goes off and pulls up that comment. So that's really cool. So the only rubbish thing here, though, is we do have a bit of an N+1 going on. So if I was to be like, oh, go collect all the contentables. It worked pretty well, but for each of them, it kind of just done a bunch of SQL queries there. So we can tidy that up a little bit. We could be like, hey, include contentable. I think it's includes, so that's going to eagle load it. Oh, it's includes, sorry. So yeah, all.includes, it's going to go look at it. We'll quickly look at this SQL it's doing. So what you can see there is it's gone ahead and instead of doing like 3 or 4 like queries or like 6 queries before, it's just kind of done 2 to actually load the content up there. So that's really, really powerful. This error which popped up when I ran dot last, this is because we don't have like an order like column or a primary key. So we have no ID and we have like no way of really easily sorting this in the Rails way. But there's a trick to sort that, and I'm gonna tell you it because it's awesome. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna create a new column on here. I'm gonna say like comments.id as ID to start with. And we're gonna do the same for the posts. So if I was to run this, I forgot the comma. If I was to run this, we now have an ID on our model, but a few of them are duplicated. So let's do something better. What we're gonna do is use the concat magic method or the function in Postgres. And we're just gonna chuck the model name before it with a little hyphen here. And we're gonna do the same for posts. And that's hopefully pretty sure, if I spell this one right as well, beautify, run current, we get some unique IDs in there, which kind of gives a hint as to what the object is and give us a primary key to search on. So let's really quickly go back and update our database view again. So this one here has that ID. So I'm going to just roll back the database. So I'm going to go back to here. I'm going to do bundle exec rails db rollback. It's going to remove the previous view. See, it's just dropped it. And we're going to put this in here. We're going to tell it to migrate again. And if I was to quickly refresh this, there we go. A little table here, or our database view now has that ID. So let's see what Rails does now. If I was just quickly reload this and get a last, it's still complaining. So we have a little bit more to do. So I'm gonna go to the model, which again, lives there. So model views, all users content. And we're gonna just tell it that there's a primary key there. Primary ID. Primary key. And we're just gonna say ID. So the reason this doesn't know that there's a primary key, if we have a look at the schema, is because it doesn't live in here. So it doesn't have its reference point. That's kind of the reason why it's not finding it, but if you define it like this, then it knows about it. No biggie. Let's reload this again. There we go. Very awesome, we can now call dot last. And that's pretty awesome, I really like that. Potentially like if we really wanted to mess around, we could put like, I don't know, like the updated ad or the created ad as well onto this to make it feel even more like a normal Rails model. Right now this is okay, but I feel like if I was to ship this to production, because there is logic in that SQL, I'd want to wrap it in a test of some form just to make sure that if someone breaks it in the future or something changes, I will feel confident that at least my code will be okay. So let's go ahead and do that. We auto-generated a little spec here earlier in the tutorial. And I've gone ahead and set up some factories for like our comments, which is here, and also our posts, which is where this data actually comes from. What I'm thinking is we just create some comments and we just go check that the contents of the table looks about right. I think that should be enough. So I'm going to go ahead and just say, right, let's describe the all method. That seems about right. And I quite like using subject in our spec right now, where I do like described class dot the thing I'm testing, and then I write my test. So I'm going to do it combines both the comment and posts tables. Cool. So yeah, let's quickly create a comment. So I'm using FactoryBot here, so I just do create comment. And because there is actually a post assigned to that comment already, it automatically creates it. I'm just going to do post equals comment.post. And I really want to see what this kind of looks like right now. So I'm just going to quickly raise comment, comma, post, and just have a quick look at what that does. So I'm just going to open a new tab and just run our spec against that file. And we're expecting it to raise here, and it should raise two objects. Cool. That's what we've got. One, two. Good stuff. Okay, cool. So what we want to do here is we want to say we expect subject.count, which is, you know, the amount of objects we get when we run views, users, all users, content.all to equal two things. It should only ever be two things, which is pretty good. That's a bit of a basic one. But let's also check something else. Like, this is kind of getting into like how you should like write your R spec. For this tutorial, I'm just going to be chucking through expectations in because you can just read them. But you could potentially make these all like three different its if you really wanted to, depending on your style. I digress, but let's do subject.collect, and let's just grab all the bodies and just be like all the bodies we've got in there, all the content, and we want it to include both the comment.body and the post.body. I think that'll work. Let's have a quick look. That should be okay. Okay, yeah, that's all good. I might just quickly put to this because I don't like it when I see a test pass. Normally, I like to see them fail first and make them pass, but like I kind of done this tutorial in the wrong order. But okay, yeah, we can see that's different content. That's good. And let's really sort this out and make sure we're really happy with it. Let's grab the contentable relationships and just check that they are these two things. So do that again. Cool, so it's passing. Again, I just really want to have a look. But so you what we are we just making sure this isn't nil? Okay, cool, good. That is the post and the comment. That is nice. Cool. So you have a reasonably nice looking test there. That's nice. One of the code blocks in the README has a nice reference as to why you should put like read-only on your model. I'm going to show you what happens if you don't put this because it's quite scary. So let's say you've got your little object here and you click save. That will just return true, and it's not actually saved to the database, which is kind of like pretending to be a model. It could be quite confusing. Let's see what happens if you just actually try and change something. So what you can see there is it threw a nice loud error, which is quite funny. And if maybe you weren't expecting this to be like a database view, maybe you didn't append it with or prepend it with the word views, it could throw you off. So yeah, let's add the def read only true, and this is just a method we overwrite which Rails looks for, and if it sees that it's true, it's going to be like, whoa, I'm not saving this data, this model, this is mad. All right, cool, so let's see what it does. So I'm going to try and update the last one here, and it says, hey, this model is marked as read only, so I'm not going to try saving it, which is super nice. And if we were to say like save as well, again we get that same very specific error as to why it can't save, which I think is a nice win. One thing I often have on like my base application record class is a couple of scopes just to sort by created at and updated at. And right now in our little database view, we don't have those fields coming in. So if I was to do like newest, it doesn't actually do too much. The oldest, yeah. And you can see it's like done the little order by, but it's kind of just gone, well, I don't know what's going on here. So let's quickly update our view to include like those columns. And it's actually pretty straightforward. I've done it ahead of time because it's kind of a bit obvious. If you got this far into the tutorial, you probably don't want to see me typing anymore. But what we do is we just take the created at and updated fields and we just alias them as columns in here. So yeah, there they are. So we're going to quickly update our view and render it a new one. So I'm going to do, just press Control R there to pull up the last time we ran Scenic, and it's got the same command in there. I think this is just going to generate like the V2 of our SQL. So let's have a little look. Yeah, there we go. So we've got a new version of our database view we're going to make, and we're going to start to update. So if we are creating a new version, we can revert between them, which is cool. And there's version two. There's the previous SQL statement. I'm just going to drop in our new one here. And I'm just going to run a bundle exec rails db migrate. And now we can like switch between the old version and the new version, which is cool. And I'm just going to quickly go to here, refresh that. There we go, got that. And if I was to quickly reload this, and if I was to be like, get me the oldest first. Yeah, kind of, no, they all made at the same time because I seeded them, but you can also do like a newest as well. Use that shared one. So that's very cool. So yeah, that's all there is on Scenic. I really, if you're ever going to be doing any complicated SQL queries, I really recommend you just kind of wrap them with this gem so you don't actually have to look at them in your code base. It's really nice. And I hope you enjoyed this and found it useful, and I'll see you again next time. Please remember to like, comment, subscribe, give me a follow on Twitter, all that good stuff. It helps a lot. I love hearing feedback. And I'll see you next time. Bye.